According to the latest U.S. government figures, there are now nearly 40 million people in this country living in poverty. That's an official poverty rate of 13.2%, up from 12.5% in the previous year. That means that, in just 1 year, another 2.5 million Americans were below the official poverty line. We have seen a steady increase in the number of people in poverty for the past decade. How many millions more are living just above the poverty line? Who are these people? When we look at other people walking down the street, sitting on a park bench, sitting in a restaurant, serving us a cup of coffee, do we have any idea what their situation might be? Do we see a scarlet letter P on their foreheads? Millions of the poor and near poor are children. Over 14 million children are in families that fall under the poverty line. What do you do when you become sick, can't work, lose your paycheck, and you and your two teenage children become homeless?
It allowed me to know, once I got down to the core of things, just that one person to be kind to you makes all the difference. Would you please stop it for a second?
What do you do when your husband leaves you with two small children and your home becomes rat infested?
I had a lot of rats coming into my house, and there was nobody to help me. And
like most people, the poor work hard to provide for themselves, for their spouses, for their children, and for other family members. Like most people, the poor care deeply about their families. They love their children just as much as anyone else does. Like most people, the poor want better lives, not just for themselves, but especially for their families, for their children. Why do we have such a negative image of the poor, especially when we don't even know who they are or how they became poor?
My own parents divorced when I was 11 years old, and suddenly my mother and her two children fell into poverty for some period of time. And it's not only that you find yourself living in a little apartment, but there's no hot water, and the bathroom is outside the house, and the shower is down the street. And because this was a kind of a kind of a cottage in a trailer park kind of situation. And so suddenly it's not only that you're poor, it's that the life you're living is one that doesn't have dignity and people don't respect you. And we have this expression that grew up, and I grew up part of my life in a trailer park. We have this expression now, people talk about trailer trash. And it shows the way that the society views people who it feels are poor, that they're trash, human trash. It's a very nasty expression.
Poverty has changed. America has changed. The world has changed. I think what we see now is a sense of hopelessness that you didn't see in the 30s or 40s or 50s or 60s, especially in the African-American community. And that sense of hopelessness is probably the most devastating thing that there is. I mean, even in the midst of poverty, people in the past believed in themselves and believed that they could do better and that things would change for them.
Poverty is like scraping the bottom of the barrel. You're trying to see your way out of a situation as far as not being able to pay your bills, not being able to buy furniture, and not being able to eat, especially when you're a diabetic. It's like being smacked in the face and kicked because you can't find and you have to deal with handouts. You're alone. You know, it's like being alone in the world, like somebody is kicking you in your teeth when you're doing the best you can to survive. That's what I feel that poverty is. It's degrading.
I'm in poverty right now, you know, and I don't show it because I don't show my feelings, you know. But I'm in poverty right now because I can't get my babies and them what they want, you know. Sometimes I can't pay my bills on time, you know. They might need something for school, and I have to tell them, hold up, be patient, it come. You know, they been patient enough for me. But it's my turn to quit saying be patient. And when they ask for it, then I can have it right there on the spot for them before they can be happy, instead of then always looking clean and be like, why we go through the struggle? That's part of life.
Everybody has their hard times. And you know, the higher class can go to the middle class and think that's poverty. But until you've lived through a week where you couldn't look at another ramen noodle, I think that you don't really know what poverty is. When you cry when you leave the store during Christmas time because you can't even afford to wrap the measly packages that you have for your kids, or you can't even afford to buy them a pair of shoes or pay their school clothes.
Staying alive, staying healthy, staying fed, keeping a roof over your head, holding the family together into one unit. That's the struggle in America. And that's poverty in America. You ask me how would I describe it? There it is, right there. You're born to struggle, and you struggle all your life. There is no easy time. Every minute of the day, you're thinking of every other minute of the day and how you're going to get through that. And then every other minute after that, low income, no health care, hold your family together, and peace of mind, you know, a little sanity, you know. You know, sometimes you really have to check your medication.
Poverty to me is you have to worry where your next meal's coming from, whether you can pay the electric bill, or whether you're maybe getting your medicine or paying the light bill, or whether you're paying the light bill and not the phone bill this month, then next month, then you got to figure out what else. So being worried on how you're going to pay your bills, if your child gets sick at school, how are you going to get to school to get your child, because you may not have bus fare because it's the middle or the end of the month. And to me, that's what poverty is. You know, you may have to eat macaroni and cheese every day for a week, or, you know.
Well, I think that it's useful to distinguish between the material conditions that we define as poor. Somebody is poor if they don't have enough to eat or enough cash to purchase enough to eat, to pay for a shelter, to pay the fees that their children have to pay to go to school or to buy the books or the uniforms to go to school or to see a doctor or to see a medicine man, to see whoever it is in their society that is authorized to treat people when they are ill and afraid. That's one kind of poverty, material poverty. But there's another dimension to poverty that is just as important, and that is that if people live in such a way that they cannot participate in the mainstream culture, in the activities, in the consumption that most people in the society think everybody should have, this so marginalizes them that is another very important dimension of poverty, especially in a consumer society like the United States.
There are two basic ways of determining who is and who is not in poverty, absolute and relative. An absolute measure of poverty sets a threshold or a line. Often that line is based on income, typically annual income. If a person or a group of people, a family or a household, has an annual income at the line or below it, they are identified as being in poverty. If their income is greater than the line, even by $1, then they are identified as not being in poverty. The line is arbitrary, but set by policymakers to help guide them in developing programs for the poor or in evaluating the effectiveness of anti-poverty programs. The lines are also used to decide who is eligible for some services. A relative measure of poverty works a little differently. Here a person or groups of people are looked at relative to the rest of their community or country or society. How do some people compare to others in their society? Are they far below or well above relative to others in terms of income, quality of housing, educational levels or opportunities, household possessions, and so on? One common relative measure is to find the median household income for a nation. The median is the point where half the households are below and half are above. A relative measure might then be defined as an income at half of the median, to give an idea how some families compare to what is typical in their society. With a relative measure, there is no hard and fast line, and it will change depending on conditions in the society as a whole.
I don't think in this country at this age in time should be so much poverty in here. And I know a lot of people don't think that this country has any poverty. You know, I actually heard that comment from several people and I just couldn't believe my eyes or my ears. Maybe that's a wish in a lot of people's minds, you know, that America doesn't have poverty, but there's a lot of poverty around. They just have to look a little bit harder, or look, because I don't think some of them are looking at all.
Well, it's, you know, conservatives often say, well, we don't really have poverty in the United States compared to poverty in Niger, for example, or compared to poverty in the Congo. That their people are starving to death, and nobody in the United States is starving. Indeed, the poor are fat, proving that we indulge them. Well, that critic might very well also look at poverty in the Netherlands, or poverty in Belgium, or poverty in Italy, or France, or Canada. And what would immediately strike any observer is that there are far fewer people in those countries who fall below either a material definition of poverty or a cultural definition of poverty. We are the most unequal country among industrial countries. We are at the head of the pack, even though we are also the richest country. Isn't that amazing?
Some people find it hard to believe that poverty exists in America. As Pat Camacho, one of our interviewees, said, and I know a lot of people don't think that this country has any poverty, but there's a lot of poverty around. They just have to look a little harder, or look because I don't think some of them are looking at all. Others insist that, while there may be some poverty in this country, it doesn't really compare to what can be found in other parts of the world, especially underdeveloped countries in Africa, Latin America, and Asia. Perceptions like these might not be so surprising among the general public, but they can be found among academics, journalists, and policymakers as well. In fact, there are individuals, particularly among political conservatives, who have made it their life work to downplay the scope and impact of poverty in America. One of the leading figures is Robert Rector, a senior research fellow at the Heritage Foundation, a conservative think tank in Washington, D.C. On their website, he is identified as a leading national figure on poverty. They go on to say that Mr. Rector directly influenced the 1996 welfare reform legislation, as well as the more recent Healthy Marriage Initiative, which has as a goal forcing women on welfare to remain in abusive marriages as a way out of poverty. On August 27, 2007, Rector published an article on the Heritage Foundation website titled, How Poor Are America's Poor? Examining the Plague of Poverty in America. Rector is not alone. In the June 7, 2010 issue of Newsweek, columnist Robert J. Samuelson draws on Rector's work to argue that the Obama administration, which has actually had little to say on the issue of poverty in America, is trying to define poverty in a way that makes it appear worse, what he calls a propaganda device to promote income redistribution. Let's look at some of Rector's and his supporters' claims. First, 43% of all poor households actually own their own homes. The average home consists of 3 bedrooms, 1.5 bathrooms, a garage, and a porch or patio, according to Rector. With the housing crisis that has overwhelmed this country in the past 3 years, Mr. Rector might want to reconsider his stance. According to the Los Angeles Times, 1 in 7 homes was past due or in foreclosure as of September 30th, 2009. Also, owning a home does not speak to the quality of the structure, to the surrounding neighborhood, or to one's ability to maintain the home, and so on. In a Cleveland Plain Dealer article about poor homeowners, information collected by the U.S. Census Bureau showed that the most common problems they experience are water leaks, roofing problems, damaged walls, and signs of rodents. In addition, water and roof problems contribute to dampness, which has been linked to asthma and other respiratory problems. Damaged walls can also lead to lead poisoning in some homes. Out of the 44 cities included in the Census Bureau survey, Cleveland was second nationwide for having the most housing with unhealthy conditions. Second, Mr. Rector claims that the poor are generally well-nourished, and that poor children are super-nourished and are 10 pounds heavier than the GIs that stormed the beaches of Normandy in World War II. What do actual experts have to say about poor children and nutrition? In January 2004, the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition published a study that linked obesity with poverty. The study was co-authored by Dr. Adam Drunowski of the University of Washington School of Public Health and Community Medicine, and by Dr. S.E. Spector, a research nutrition scientist at the U.S. Department of Agriculture. An article about this study on the Science Daily website noted that low-income consumers are more likely to purchase high-calorie, energy-dense foods, that is, foods that are higher in fat, sugar, or salt. such foods are more likely to contain empty calories, nutrition-poor elements that the body often converts directly to fat. The reason healthier diets are beyond the reach of many people is that such diets cost more, Dr. Drewnowski said in the Science Daily article. On a per-calorie basis, diets composed of whole grains, fish, and fresh vegetables and fruit are far more expensive than refined grains, added sugars, and added fats. Researchers with the University of Pennsylvania, Johns Hopkins University, and other institutions have found that poor teenagers, ages 15 to 17, are 50% more likely to be overweight than non-poor teens in the same age range. A higher percentage of overweight teens being poor was also found among males and females, as well as among whiter African American adolescents. It is important to recognize that the poverty threshold is based on the cost of the cheapest diet, not on a more expensive but more nutritionally sound diet. Third, according to Mr. Rector, nearly 75% of poor households own a car, 31% own two or more. The simple fact of car ownership begs a lot of questions. Do those cars work? How old are they? How safe are these vehicles? Did they come off big lots in suburban locations with a fair price for the buyer? According to Professor Howard Carger of the University of Houston, poor people pay more for transit than the non-poor. Because of credit problems, many poor people go to buy here, pay here car lots, where down payments are large, payments are made weekly, and where late payments can result in the car being repossessed. In times like these where credit is tight, the situation for the poor is even worse, since their options are more limited than ever. These fringe car lots are more profitable than conventional dealerships because their captive audiences have a lack of buying options. Research published in Social Indicators Research challenges the conventional wisdom that not having a car is an indicator of hardship. In other words, car ownership can distort the real picture of disadvantage. The evidence shows that zero car ownership can actually be a positive feature for low-income households. Conversely, high car ownership can put serious financial strain on households with low incomes. Why do we hear these ideas? Since the Nixon administration, and then accelerating during the Reagan era, there has been a war on the poor. Scapegoating. Blaming the victim. Cries that welfare is draining the national budget. Yet the reality of life in America is far different. It is the rich, not the poor, who have sucked up the wealth and resources of our country. For several decades, we have seen tax cut after tax cut that mainly benefits the rich. Subsidies for the wealthy, such as home mortgage interest tax deductions that go mainly to the affluent. Corporate welfare. So-called authorities like Rector and Samuelson are nothing but lackeys for the powerful, the wealthy. How are they any different than the Limbaughs and the Becks and the O'Reillys? What is the purpose behind what they say? Other than the propaganda they produce, based on shoddy research and misleading conclusions, justifying the comfortable lives of those at the top, built off the exploitation and degradation of the poor and the near poor. They may be less strident than their mercenary counterparts on the cable news networks and talk radio. They may wrap what they say in the trappings of academies. But the Rectors and the Samuelsons and the Pauls are no less delivering a message of hate and anger and fear, all drawn from their own greed, which seems to have convinced them that everyone else is the same as them and only wants to take away what they have. Why have so many people in this country never learned to share? How sad. Better come on in my kitchen.
The federal guideline, which has actually been in place since about 1963, it was set up so that when they started the war on poverty, they would be able to show success by showing that fewer and fewer people live below this line. That's what the line is a measure of mostly. It's also sometimes used to for income eligibility for access to programs. I asked my students, just to help them learn about this issue, to go out and interview people who, just someone who isn't informed about social welfare issues, social work issues, to ask them what they think a family of three or a family of four needs to live on today. And they'll ask a relative, a friend, parent, and they say somewhere between $35,000 and $50,000. And then they're shocked when they see what the actual federal poverty line is.
We have a kind of mean-spirited measure of poverty, but even so, we have a lot of poor people. We use a measure that's based on a market basket of subsistence foods, and then we multiply that by three, and we say anybody who is below that number in income is poor. So, I mean, the number includes the cheapest foods and so forth, and it isn't enough really to pay for actual housing costs, which have inflated much more rapidly than food costs.
How do we define poverty officially in the United States? We use an absolute measure. It was first developed by economist Molly Orshansky in 1963 when she was working for the Social Security Administration. In the 1950s, the Department of Agriculture completed a survey on household food consumption. This led to a series of estimates of how much households spent on food each month, one of which was the Thrifty Food Plan. At the time, economists estimated that the typical family of three or more spent about one-third of their disposable after-tax income on food. So by multiplying the amount of money spent on food by three, Molly Orshansky arrived at what came to be the poverty threshold. She then adjusted it for different sizes of families, for both one adult and two adult families, as well as the number of children in the family. That is the poverty threshold. It is still used in the United States, although it is adjusted annually for inflation so that comparisons can be made over time.
The political problem is the higher you raise that poverty line, the more people are defined as poor because more people fall under it. So the politicians are not eager to have a more robust poverty line because it makes their efforts to, it brings poverty into the national attention. It makes it much more of a troublesome issue for politicians. So so we really don't have an accurate number of, we have a very low number in terms of the people who are actually poor. So any time you hear, you know, 12% of families or people are poor, double it and you'll have a better sense of what the real figure is.
Most policymakers and social scientists now acknowledge that the official poverty line is far from adequate and that it underestimates the actual extent of poverty in this country. Most low-income families do not spend a third of their income any longer on food. In fact, rent has become the biggest household expense, consuming about half of the typical low-income family's budget. So most could not afford to spend a third of their after-tax income on food, even if they need to. Many services now use a guideline that is greater than the actual poverty guideline. Food stamps and free school lunches, for example, use 130% of the federal guideline. SCHIPS, the state children's health insurance program, is authorized to go even higher, to at least 200%, or double the actual guideline. According to many experts, for example, the National Center for Children in Poverty, a family needs an income of at least twice the poverty guideline in order to get by. So the term low income has come into common use, and it is defined as twice the official poverty guideline.
Have about, I think, something like 25% of our children are being raised in poverty in the United States. Here in Cincinnati, we have a figure like that. And not only do we have that, but we also have one of the highest infant mortality rates in the in the state, in the country. We have a very high infant mortality rate here in the city of Cincinnati, and that's an indicator of poverty.
Well, I think poverty has to entail how people live and perhaps how they're not able to live. And a lot of people are struggling, I think. I think probably whatever the poverty rate number is, it's probably worse than that. I've been amazed at some of the kinds of reports and studies that have come out around, not in Cincinnati, but some of the suburban counties that that takes a look at what it might actually require as a minimum wage for people to live at a basic sort of middle class lifestyle for a family of four with a kid in school and kid out. One of the neighboring, you know, counties to here, it's like $56,000 a year. I know that the poverty rate is somewhere around $20,000 for a family of four or somewhere in that area. So I mean, that's a huge disparity as to, you know, what poverty actually means as a legal official definition and how people can actually live and grow and flourish and, you know, take advantage of the American dream or what have you.
Well, Cincinnati, I think, as I say, like most other cities, has been dominated by a handful of big multinational corporations and banks. In this city, the most important of those is Procter & Gamble, which has dominated the city for many years. Other corporations would be the Federated Department Stores, now called Macy's. The Fifth Third Bank has been an important bank here. Kroger, which has its national headquarters here, and so on. There's seven of these corporations. The executives of those corporations make salaries, in some cases, in the several millions of dollars per year. And they are the ones who tend to dominate local politics. How do they do that? They provide tens of thousands of dollars for candidates for office. They play a big role in the Republican and the Democratic parties. They are ever present in every organization of the city. And I would argue that even when they're in a minority, everyone knows that they are the powerful, wealthy men, usually men, sometimes women, in the city to whom one must defer. So when somebody from Procter & Gamble comes into the board meeting and sits down and says, we're prepared to do this or not to do this, that will tend to determine what happens in the board meeting. That's what it means to have run a city for 100 or 150 years and to have always sat on those boards and have always had the initiative. It's not only a question of money and power, but also of the confidence of that ruling elite that they're the ones in charge.
When I first got sick, I thought that was my biggest problem. When I first got sick in 2001, I thought that was my biggest problem. But then I had hope that I was going to get better. I didn't, like I say, in 2001, I had cancer. A small cell lymphoma, and I had a lump in my chest. And then in 2002, in 2001, I found too that I had a lump in my left breast. Then 2002, I found that I had a big knot on my neck and a big thing on my right eye. And they were both cancerous. And I went in and they removed the knot on my neck, but they shrunk the thing and lanced it on my eye. And then they gave me that aggressive chemo and all of my hair came out. And when all of my hair came out, that was depressing. And so then 2003, I thought maybe I would be getting a little better. And my teeth start crumbling and they start falling out. And so the expenses of trying to maintain a secondhand body is like a secondhand car. And between the secondhand body and I have a secondhand car, I stay broke or stay begging all the time. So it's a financial struggle.
You mentioned about your home. You've had some problems here in taking care of it and problems that have happened. You said something about a water leak?
Yeah. It first started when the building right next door on this side, they had had leaks for years. And then 2003, I was here and I was ill. And when I came back on Memorial Day from the cemetery, and I went in my kitchen, and the drywall and the cabinets and all fell off the wall in the kitchen on the floor. And I couldn't tell where the water was coming from, and I went up to the second floor and the water was up there, and then when I went to the third floor was totally dry, and that really baffled me. Where was this water coming from? We kept trying to figure out what was going on, and so my insurance company didn't cover it. And so then I was really stuck. And then I didn't have money to fight it. And then I finally discovered that it was coming from the roof next door. And so the president of the community council, he came over and he looked at it and he went up on the roof, and then we went down and talked to the man, and it's the man that owns this Jack's store down there. He owns that building also. And he said he was gonna fix it. And he keeps saying he's gonna fix it, and he still hasn't fixed it.
What I experienced, because it was not my fault, I worked. You know, I'm a single parent. And I felt like I made it, you know, I allowed myself in this situation fine. You know, it's not gonna be easy, but I'll do the best that I can, you know. And I fell into a hardship. What happened was the apartment where I lived at had gotten infested with bed bugs. I was not familiar with bed bugs at all. So I ended up throwing away all my furniture and everything, and because I had to take me and my children back and forth to the doctor because I was allergic to the bites. This was, I mean, at the time they didn't realize it was an epidemic. Well, at least that's what they were saying. He's scratching now. It's long gone. I'm not there anymore anyway. And then I threw everything that I had. It was just like, and I couldn't believe I did that, but it was like, man, this has been a terrible year. Things that I've had since my children were born. I took and we cleaned the place real good. We started getting rid of certain items of furniture, articles of furniture, and belongings that we had, only to find out that you have to like get rid of anything that's like cloth, such as a couch, or anything, any fabrics, mattresses, anything like that, carpet, you know. Then my child had, my daughter, start breaking out in like ringworm type rashes because they can't diagnose you for having bed bug bites. So I had to take her. And we then received some cream. The cream they gave me irritated my skin even more. So I had to go to a dermatologist. So they really didn't know how to classify it or even what to suggest because you can't diagnose anyone once again with bed bugs. And that hasn't been a common thing in years, you know. So how do you diagnose someone or even give them a prescription to try and better them, you know? So that went out the window, as well as my job, because by then, between me, my son and daughter, they all went to the hospital. I had to take them to the hospital only to go back to be given more and other medications. Then we all had to go to a dermatologist. So my job wasn't happy with that, so I then lost my job. And so in that, once I lost my job, how do I pay the rent? And then for me to be coming to a homeless situation, that's the most isolated, desoluted feeling a person can experience. That's the closest feeling to death you can ever have, because you just a step away from saying, fuck it, let me be done with it. This is an ongoing situation. I never thought I would become homeless. You know, I never phantomed or even fancied the idea. That never went past my head, you know. So I can only imagine how many other people that experienced that and it never went past theirs. But yet, we still look down upon them. Who am I to judge them? I don't know where they came from.
I was more or less by myself, on my own, with my two children, with a house full of rats. And that was the worst poverty that I've ever lived. There was no food in my house. I couldn't have any food because of the rats. They were destroying the house. They were making holes all over the place. We used to sleep in one room, and I used to put a towel on the bottom of the door. I learned that I can do things by myself because I couldn't wait for somebody to come and rescue me. So I remember getting up in the morning, like 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning, to pick up the rats that were in the floor so my daughters wouldn't see it. And but I did it. I did it, and so that's what I mean by learning. I learned how to deal with that situation. Then I started doing the same thing with the rest of my house. I started little by little buying things and patching up the holes that the rats had made. And then I waited after a while, and I got a loan to fix some of the things.
My mother and father there were 5 children. Uh-huh. And my mother and father separated. My father left us. My mother had 5 children to raise with no money. She worked a part-time job at night, and she had 3 girls and 2 boys. We lived in a two-bedroom house, a kitchen and a bedroom, you know, 5 children. And my mother would not eat until all of us had ate. And then a lot of times there was no food left. We slept on a mattress on the floor, 5 children. She slept on a chair or a couch, if we were fortunate enough to have one. And we didn't have a whole lot of food to go around, you know, but if it wasn't but a loaf of bread, you know, we could eat as much as we could. You know, we went to school, I wore an outfit one day, my sister wore it the next day, and the other sister wore it, and, you know, because we, you know, we had to wash our clothes out on our hands in cold water. It sounds horrible, but children do not really know poverty until they get grown. If they're hungry and you give them a piece of bread and it helps them, they are happy. So, yeah. And then we moved into a 3-room apartment and we thought we were rich.
Well, I was raised in a children's home. From the time I was 6 and a half months old, I had a twin sister, and we were both taken to the children's home at 6 and a half months, and I was there off and on till I was 17, till I got married. But someone came and got my sister, and kept her. They got paid for keeping people from the home, but when they found out I had rheumatic fever, nobody wanted the expense, you know, to take care of me. They wouldn't get the money that it would cost for my medical care, so I spent most of the time in the children's home. Well, my father was a policeman, and my mother was just a housewife. And I don't know, they just had a disagreement one time, and he just left. And I had five brothers, and he took the boys, and he didn't want the girls. He said the girls weren't his. So Mom just took us to the children's home. So they just separated and got divorced, and he married again, and she married again. And he went to Phoenix, Arizona. I was like 9 years old, 9 or 10, right after I found out I had rheumatic fever. And I went to this place, and it was called McQuarters in Hamilton, Ohio. And it was on Stahlhaber Road. I'll never forget it. And they had twins, a boy and a girl named Linda and Leonard. And on Saturday, I used to have to cook breakfast for 8 people. I mean, I'm 9 years old, and I would fix pork chops and fried potatoes. And we had this butter. It was white butter that had a yellow dot in it, and used to squeeze it. You had to squeeze it to make it yellow. Have you ever seen it? Well, that's country butter. That's how they had it. But I used to cook breakfasts on the weekends for a family of 8. Big breakfasts, biscuits, all kinds of stuff. And then I had housework to do. And Linda and Leonard wouldn't do nothing. After they ate, they got to watch cartoons. And I used to have to ask them to pick up their feet so I could sweep, you know. And they used to kick at the sweeper and stuff like that. I used to try to hit them, but I always got caught. They never caught them, but they'd always catch me. But I met this little boy at church, and he used to throw paper wads at me, and I just ate that up, you know. I thought, well, he likes me, you know. So, but he was 16 and I was 15. So I knew, I was smart enough to know I'd never get out of the children's home. To get out of the children's home, to be a girl, you had to be 21. A boy could get out at 18. And in order for a girl to get out, you know, she had to get pregnant or something, you know, something had to happen. So I got pregnant, and they made him marry me, you know. And that's how I got out. That's a terrible way to have to get out, but that's what I did it for. And that's a shame to say, but that's why I did it.
There were no benefits when I started where I was working. And but we made do, because in America, low-income family, you know how to make do. So we made do. Wife's a diabetic. Minor kids, no health care on my job. Her job didn't have enough health care for her, the kids, and me too. And then she's been diabetic all her life. She's deteriorating. Doctor put her on disability. In order to have the health care necessary for a diabetic wife, and it's a lot of money a month with all the complications and other medications she has to have besides the insulin 2 or 3 times a day, we split the family. I moved out, got a place of my own. Kids, wife and kids are in another household so that she can get state assistance for the health care. And it's been like that for a while. It shouldn't be like that. It shouldn't have never happened in America like that. But that's what America has brought us to. So it's cheaper to pay 2 households than one insurance policy. It's cheaper, you know. Our medical expenses would be at least $500 a month. Keep my wife alive and keep my blood pressure down, you know.
Well, my family, we come from the country, and back then people kind of just, they got by, you know. I don't think people were rich back then. A lot of people owned their land, and they got by. They farmed their own food, and they just barely got by. When they got to the city, a lot of Appalachian people, especially back in the 50s and 60s, came up here into Cincinnati looking for jobs, and they couldn't find. Jobs ran out after lots of people came because there was a big migration from the Appalachian region. And then my dad kind of came up to the city for that reason. And I think they had had three or four kids by the time they came to Cincinnati. And they got here and they ended up in a poverty situation. He had a few jobs, and I think my dad kind of just gave up. They ended up with nine kids by the time they were in Cincinnati. They ended up having nine kids, and it was really hard to make it. Welfare was a different system back then. And my dad got real frustrated, and different reasons. He actually went back to Kentucky, left my mom here in Cincinnati. So my mom raised nine kids on basically nothing, whatever she could get. And she ended up being on welfare and just kind of struggling by. So as a kid, I mean, we didn't think of ourselves in poverty, but we knew there was a lot of things that we didn't have that we wanted, you know, and she did the best that she could over the years. And then, I mean, growing up, by the time I was 15, I got out and tried to find myself a job, and we tried to make money however we could. That's kind of what I think about poverty. And now, you know, as growing up, we were kind of in poverty, and you know, it's really hard to get out of poverty and move on, and we have a lot of kids that. A lot of people in my family didn't make it through their education to get their high school diploma and go on to college, so it's really hard to move out of poverty.
My dad married a babysitter, and that is where my troubles begin. After he married the babysitter and moved across the street and totally denied us, I believe I was at the age of 13, 14 years old when this happened. Instead of adopting alcoholism, I used drugs, and I wanted him to hate me the way I was hating him at that particular moment because of the drug. I mean, because, you know, he was an alcoholic, he married the babysitter, and then he had a daughter with her before we even knew that this child was my father's baby. And so that is where my beginning of my drug use. I stayed clean for 10 years, and then I relapsed after I completed the program. That's when my mother, also my daughter, my 16-year-old, was diagnosed with kidney and lung cancer. At the same time, my mother's, in the same year, 98, February, my daughter was diagnosed with kidney Wilms tumor, is what they call it. And then September of 98, my mother's car wreck. And in December 98 is when she had her first stroke. So I was very overwhelmed with responsibilities. And then my little brother, little cousin, was attention deficit disorder, having to take off work to, you know, come to his needs and things. I was really, really stressed out. But those are the things that drove me back to using. I went from, as some people call them, abandonmentiums. When I went out this last time using, I lived in empty apartments. I lived with anybody that would allow me to live. I lived under conditions that only way I could stay the night is to bring drugs in for the person who allowed me to stay there. That was their way of making me pay to spend the night there. So it was a constant hustle on the streets, and maybe someone would come through and offer you a night out to get high with them, and that's where you end up spending the night at that day. But there was consequences behind it, the things you had to do for it, you know, stuff like that. You know, sometimes you had to fight because you don't want to do what they want to do, or you get put out and have to walk back, you know, or sometimes some guys just felt like they could take it and in the hell with you, you know. It was all kind of different situations that we put ourselves in a lot of danger. So I know what it is. I know what it's like out there to be hungry, to be lost, to be homeless,
And they always say that lonely, hungry, and bored is really the things that cause people to go back out and do the things and to get into situations. I keep plenty, as you might see, I have two refrigerators. I have two refrigerators full of food. I never today allow myself to be hungry. As you see, I have animals. I have my daughters. I have my neighbors. I have my job. I have friends. They don't allow me to be bored or lonely because they're always at my door. They don't run in and out, but they're always, what are you doing today? How are you feeling? You doing okay? It used to get on my nerves, but today it's a blessing from God, because if I did need them, I know that they're there.
Situation is such that you're going to begin to see a real gap between the rich and the poor, and all indication is clearly that. But this is happening not just in Cincinnati or this nation, it's happening worldwide. This is being exacerbated. Globalization has produced massive, massive inequality, and no one's really talking about that.
So we have a society that produces, on the one hand, enormous accumulation of wealth for one social group, the people who own businesses, industries, banks, insurance companies, and so on. And in order to do that, they also have to carry out the systematic exploitation of their workforce in order to grind that poverty out of them. And so I think that's the essence of this system. This is a system meant to produce an accumulation of wealth on the one hand, and on the other, that produces poverty. And even from the point of view of the economists, we have an unemployment rate of 5%, and the economist will say, well, that's good, or that's a normal rate of unemployment, or that's a healthy rate of unemployment. Well, it may be a normal, healthy rate of unemployment for an employed economist, but it is not a healthy rate of unemployment for the unemployed.
Poverty. It is really not a complicated problem. You know, they used to say, well, the solution to poverty is to give people money, and that is a good solution. The other solution is to give them the kind of work to do which will enable them not to be poor, to get health care, to overcome the traumas that afflict all people in the course of their life. People have to be sustained during those traumas, otherwise they'll go down into the pit and not be able to climb out. But, you know, these, not complicated how to do that. If it were complicated, all affluent countries would have large numbers of poor people, but they don't.
The reason we have poverty is that there aren't enough jobs to go around for everybody who needs a job. People don't have a way to earn a living so that they won't be poor. So, and in most market economies, it kind of helps to have some people poor, helps to have some people unemployed, because that helps allows employers to pay less, pushes wages down if more people are looking for jobs. So poverty is kind of functional in some ways for the powers that be, not for the people who suffer it. It's exacerbated by low minimum wages. It's exacerbated by inadequate public benefits, which are meant to cushion people against poverty. In other words, if you have a higher minimum wage, you're going to have less poverty. So it's kind of a structural, poverty is a structural fact of life.
American Welfare System, or AFDC, before it was transformed into TANF, It affects poverty in really two ways. One is that it gives people, women and children, a little bit of assistance. But the other way in which it also affects poverty is that welfare as an institution helps to create the image of what it means to be poor, so that if you needed that little bit of assistance, you had to go through a welfare application process, which was a defining process. It was a demeaning protest. The interrogations, the scrutiny, the home investigations, the constant surveillance helped to define what it means to be poor in the United States. It means that you don't have rights. You know, we don't. We give farmers subsidies and have for 70 or 80 years, but we don't investigate them. We don't make them apply in by filling out lengthy forms and by subjecting them to interrogations. So it wasn't the receipt of welfare which was so demeaning. We could have, if we had just given people a little check, that would have been nice and would have been enough. But it was the way we treated them in the welfare system.
You are just there at the mercy of other people. And sometimes they're kind, and sometimes they're rude. And it's hard when they're rude. Mm-hmm. And like social workers and people constantly talk down to you. And you're angry, but if you speak out or speak up, you just make it worse for yourself. So you just go along with things you definitely don't like. Tough pill to swallow.
Mm-hmm. Well, I remember I had worked at Hutch and I had got laid off right before Christmas. And I didn't know if they were going to call me back or not. And so I went down to apply for some services until I could get my unemployment. And I went and I went. And like the fourth time I was down there, I was a little upset, you know, utterly. I had no income coming in. My rent was due. My kids I needed groceries for my kids. And the lady actually had me escorted out by a guard. I hadn't even, all I said was, you know, this has been like 2 months, and what else do you need? And so she had me escorted out. And so I actually went to Santa Maria agency. Well, my friend made me go, and I told him what was going on. And so the lady called down there. They brought me in the next day. We met with her supervisor. And before I left there, I had food stamps in my hand. But because, I mean, it was like a 2 month, I couldn't understand, you know, what was going on, and she kept saying I needed something, and I couldn't understand what else I needed. I just feel that sometimes they talk down to you, and I didn't feel that she should be talking down to me. You know, I have worked. It wasn't that I wasn't working, and I was laid off, and I needed some help at that time.
Being in an agency, I think most people start out being very good people and well-intended. And I think, you know, they get very overburdened and they work, you know, they have very high caseloads and stuff. And sometimes, you know, they get really hardcore and they're not as nice to people as they should be. You know, there's some people that are very committed and they really are there to help people. And I think they just kind of get overworked. You know, I've heard of caseloads that have like 50, 60, 70 people, you know, tons of people, hundreds of people sometimes if it's a Department of Human Services. You know, and I think people kind of just get cold-hearted after a while, and it gets really hard on them because they're being stressed to their levels, too.
Does anybody really want to be in the Human Services building? I mean, I don't see anybody jumping with glee to get in there. And when you walk in, there is a degree of humiliation that you that you face. It's like telling your parents that you're bad or something, you know, I need help, I did something wrong. Well, the only thing that I did wrong was leave a battering situation. And to me, that was the right thing to do for my children. And they questioned me on that, you know, how come you didn't stay with them, et cetera. No one ever asked me if I was safe in my home. No one ever screened me for domestic violence. And as such, they still have not, even though certain things have been put into place where they should. But always, I have been made to feel like I am lesser.
Yeah, I have experience with the food pantry, you know. And, you know, with them, they're nice, you know. They don't turn you away, you know. And I appreciate that because, you know, too many people don't want to give out nothing because they feel like, you know, you would take it and go out here and sell it. No, I have babies to feed. If I don't feed them babies, something wrong with me.
The idea that we had any responsibility for each other, which there was some sense of in this country for many decades, was very consciously destroyed. And it was destroyed by political conservatives or neoliberal liberals, destroyed by people who very consciously put an emphasis on the private accumulation of wealth, the status of the elites. All of our TV shows that come to be about lawyers and investors and rich families and so on, and the denigration of people who making fun of and ridiculing people who work for a living, so that the whole concept of the dignity of labor has been destroyed, the whole concept that working people actually know how to do things, which of course it's working people who know how to do all the things that happen in our society. Nothing would happen without them. There's been a really systematic campaign to denigrate working class people and to destroy the notion that working class people have something to contribute. So I think part of such a campaign to change social attitudes is to say that that working for a living is a good thing. How would you like other people to treat you?
Same way I treat them. Treat me with respect. I treat you with respect. I mean, don't push my buttons too bad. I don't push your buttons too bad. I mean, just like I said, do to others as you want to be done to. Treat others the way you want to be treated. That's the way I see it. If you want to be treated like shit, treat me like shit. I'll treat you like shit. If you want to be a nice guy, I'll be a nice guy. That's how it is. I'll walk up to a stranger, I mean anywhere, just talk about the weather or something. I'll see somebody walking out of work I don't even know, one of the big high dollar scientists. Told them when it was snowing or I'd be like, be careful, the roads are getting bad, and they look at me like, thank you. And I mean, some of them, they don't want to give you the time of the day. They'll put their head down, they'll walk, they'll look over here. I mean, they won't look at you. They'd rather stare at the ground than talk to you. They're afraid to talk to you or something. I don't know, like, I have like middle class disease or something. Afraid they're gonna catch it. I mean, you're like everybody else. We're all human. We're all Homo sapiens. Or some people just need to learn that not everything is based on what you have and what you do.
How do you think that people like that, people from these offices here, wearing suits and, you know, how would they react if they walked through there to what they see?
Let's see. They walk through Washington Park on a bright sunny day with the suits on and stuff. First thing they think, we are nothing. We're disgust. But they don't realize, because you got on a suit and a tie, that don't mean a person out here, your caliber ain't out here with us. You can have all the money in the world, but if somebody out here with the same money you got is sitting out here and relaxing and chilling just like we are. And you know, they judge you. Yeah, look at them. They dirty. They don't want to do nothing but want to drink, smoke, you know, do nothing. Just sit on their lazy butt. But if you change, turn the ties on them and put them out there and put me in a suit and tie, then you'll feel where I'm coming from. But until then and that, you'll be like, oh, I don't need nothing. They ain't nothing, they below. But you got some out there do care about us. Will come over here, sit there, talk to us, play cards with us, play chess, you know, just kicking the breeze out there having fun with us. But the ones who think they're the stuff will overlook us and just put their nose up in the air and just walk past us, you know, say ignorant stuff out of their mouth.
Well, the way I see that they view the poor is that they're low life, they think they're criminals, they think they're always looking for a handout, they think they're not trying to do everything they can to get out of poverty. They think that they're just in the way, really. Because, like for instance, downtown, all the people that they moving out, they cannot afford those buildings, so it's like, I guess they view us as ants. We're just like ants, army ants, that's wanting stuff all the time. It's like we're criminals all the time. Every poor person in poverty is out to get stuff for free. Things like that, which is not true at all. But if you watch the news, how they portray poor people as thieves and everything else, you will. How they portray them as everybody is trying to get things.
I think a lot of people think the poor are there because it's their fault, that they've done something or won't do something. And I think that's a very wrong impression because that's not true. You know, people, you know, when you lose your job, you didn't lose your job because you weren't doing, they moved it overseas or, you know, they downsized. It's not because of something you've done. So I think the general belief is that poor people are poor because they want to be poor. They don't want to better themselves. They're not trying to do anything, and that's not true. That's not true at all.
Notice that the political rhetoric attacking programs that help the poor almost always evokes images of black people and images of sexual promiscuity, which, you know, creates a lot of that trembling anxiety in a lot of Americans. So that part of our past helps, I think, to turn people's eyes away and their brains away from what is a much more important fact, and that is that having a lot of poor in a society, a lot of poor people, and treating those poor people in a way that makes them miserable and demeans them is not only bad for the poor, it's also bad for the great mass of working people who are kept in line by evoking the threat that you will become poor. Sustaining in a way a large, 37 million people are below our official poverty line, and many more are what somebody from Belgium would consider poor. Sustaining this broad stratum of castigated, marginalized people is also a way of disciplining the great majority of people who we call the middle class.
To really get together and quit being so selfish and self-centered and, oh, that's not my problem, that's not my, how, why should I be concerned, that's not my problem. If you are in this society or if you live in this country, it is, you know, it's everybody's problem, it's everybody's concern, and until we look at it like that, it's going to continue to be a growing problem. You know, and it'll spread like a bad cancer until we stand up and say, you know what, we have these monies available, this is what we need to be doing for this, this is, we need to open up this so these people can get these jobs, you know, open up the opportunities, open up the possibilities, don't be scared, because if you be scared, you take a chance of losing out, and self-destruction shall conquer us all.
Is that true with people too, that we just throw them
away? We just throw them away. And we need to stop. Everyone is a valuable person, and everyone has something to contribute. And maybe if someone shows them kindness and that they care about them, that's going to change that person's life. I firmly believe in that.
There's low-income people, and I'm at the very bottom of the rung. They're too desperate to be nice. They're desperate for every waking hour of the day. They want a cigarette. They want a drink of pop. They want a meal. They want clean clothes. They want to get off this street and stop this rain and snow from falling on their heads and can't get out of it.
I was taught a very long time ago by my saintly grandmother that when times get tough and the chips are down, pick up some chips. If you only have two chips left, and help someone else out. And by helping other people out, my God, as much as I think it's really bad for me, there's a lot of people that have it a lot worse than I do. So by helping to empower those people, it makes me feel like I'm still human, like I'm just not another number that's been shuffled under the rug. And if I can still help people and empower people, then it gives me a sense of strength within myself that, you know, I need to live what I'm teaching. And if I'm telling this person, you know, that they can get over and above this, then I have to live it too.
Because now we're in the 2009 and we have to stimulate the economy. And part of what they tell us about stimulating the economy is we all need to go out here and spend. We got to get you spending again. We got to get you buying cars and houses and big screen TVs. And we need America. We're going to send you a stimulus check and you need to run right to Walmart and buy something. It's like, that stimulates the economy? Well, when you were giving poor people welfare checks, what do you think they did with it? They spent it. They poured it all right back in. You know, so if giving people help, giving people money to put in the economy stimulates the economy, that's exactly what welfare did. You know, every person I knew on welfare or know on welfare, when they get their check, they spend it. And it goes right back into the economy. So if the government can print up money to give away with the expectation that people will then spend, I know a way to do that. Give it to the poor people who spend. That's why in poor communities, there are thriving stores. Poor communities have an economy all their own. These little corner stores that sell beer and wine and cigarettes and pop and potato chips, they're here for a reason. These little stores that fry up chicken wings all day long, they're here for a reason. They're businesses in poor communities because they're dollars that circulate.
Poverty can be virtually eradicated. Moreover, it can be virtually eradicated at a fairly low cost. It's not an expensive project. Give people decent training, decent work, subsidize their health care because nobody can afford to buy health care on the market, subsidize housing costs, particularly in the big cities, because we've allowed housing costs to spiral out of sight for poor people. We have to do some things like that, but it's not complicated and it's not beyond us. Think of the trillions, many trillions of dollars already spent by the Federal Reserve and the Treasury to shore up the banks, or the $3 trillion that Joseph Stiglitz and his colleagues estimate we have spent on war. Getting rid of poverty would be cheaper by far.
Let's just get rid of it. We don't want it. You know, what should be done about poverty? I think the whole question again of higher wages, it's jobs and income. When you talk about economic poverty, it's you need steady work, decent paying jobs, a higher minimum wage. There are many living wage campaigns around the country. People are arguing for this. There's less argument for income support programs. The public has really turned against them during this past period. They've always been against them. They turned against them some more. But I think we have to argue for stronger income support systems, especially since the economy is less welcoming to more and more people. Even when we get out of this mess that we're in, there can be a lot of people who the jobs are not going to come back.
People need housing. They'll say that one of the number one, or probably the number one need on the part of homeless people, or the reason why people are homeless, is because they can't afford housing. There's also, I mean, we have to add jobs in here and have to add income in here. I mean, there's sort of a major weird contradiction between the housing market and the work market and labor market, because the labor market obviously could only, you know, if you, I mean, you can't exist on minimum wage anymore. I mean, I exist on minimum wage when I was married. My wife worked in less than minimum wage in a department store, and to get me through school. But you could do that then. You can't even begin to do that now. So the you have a real desperate situation where the labor market and what it can afford or supposedly pay people can't even begin to touch what the housing market can provide. The market left to its own devices tends to produce homogeneity. It doesn't tend to produce, you know, heterogeneity, inclusion. It tends to produce exclusive enclaves by income generally. That's what markets tend to do, and they're very good at it. So if you want to have the market run full tilt, and that becomes your answer for creating an economic mix, I don't buy it. It's not going to work.
There's a lot of caring people about there, and I think there's people that just aren't aware. You know, they just don't live in the poor neighborhoods, and I don't think they realize what kind of problems exist. I think sometimes there's people that do know, and then there's people that just don't have a clue about who the poor are.
Well, that's an interesting question. Do we as a society have a responsibility? I think we should have such a responsibility. My fear is that we don't. And through this term econocide, what I think is going on is that not only that we don't, but that we don't care that we don't. So it's, but at the same time, you know, you hear the stuff about America's a compassionate country and that kind of stuff. But I think right now, empathy is in pretty short supply.
There are always consequences to actions, and those in power really don't know what they're doing. They have no idea what the consequences of their actions are. They make decisions that are oftentimes snap decisions that sound good and feel good, but they don't see 20 years down the road because they don't look 20 years down the road. They may look to the next election to come and say, you know, I pushed for 45 more police officers on the street, vote for me again. but they don't see any further down the road.
I think that one result of 30 years, really, since the last 2 years of the Carter administration, but certainly escalating when Ronald Reagan took office, one result of 30 years of castigation of the poor is that even liberals and progressives who are politicians are afraid of the word poverty or the poor or programs like welfare. They won't touch those terms. They're toxic. They're afraid of them. And the Obama administration won't touch them either unless they are forced to.
I think that the people who dominate this society now, that is the banking and financial and industrial corporations and other corporations, service corporations, that dominate government and politics in this society now, cannot be relied upon to do something about poverty. Nor do I think you can rely on the political parties that we have today. The Republicans and the Democrats are both parties of big business and big corporations.
You let somebody like me from over the Rhine, an inner city, low income, single mother, and disabled to boot, call a legislator and ask for a meeting. Oh, well, he's booked up for right now, and next week he's going on vacation. And one legislator, we actually had to tell him that we was a fifth grade class coming to talk about how our government works. And when we got there and he seen that we weren't kids, he was very upset with us. But that was the only way. It was, oh, well, I've got a meeting here, I've got to go here, and I'll be out of the office that day. And oh, then next week I got to go on vacation. I haven't had vacation in, you know. So you can't get them to meet with you. It's like, if you're low income, you don't have no needs. You know, toss them in the river and get rid of them.
Better call in my kitchen. Bound to be right at our doors.
I think one of the problems is that poverty really does bad things to people. We know that people who have lost their jobs lose their sense of identity. The first time you meet someone, they always say, oh, I'm Dan, what do you do? And of course, the person who's unemployed feels they have no identity. The person who, you know, they lose their identity, and that's terribly devastating to a person's ego and so on. So what do people do? They become involved in drugs and alcohol. What else happens? Well, people, some people become very poor and they turn to crime. So it's not like being poor doesn't lead to consequences that change people and that are bad. And it's not like all the perceptions about the poor are completely wrong or unrealistic. But it seems to me that the poor can be changed by being drawn in to a new social life, a new social movement with a different ethos.
I think in situations of oppression, it's always the group that's oppressed that has to educate those that don't understand it. I mean, you hear that around race, you hear that around gender issues, you hear that around class issues. Is that, and how to get people to believe what our experience is. I believe we have a responsibility to eradicate poverty. And I think it's good, like sharing resources, helping is just dealing with the symptoms, I think. But we do have a responsibility to figure out how can we end the situation that people are having to stand in line for food. I mean, sometimes people want to give and want to help, and it's out of that spirit of, oh, like charity. We've got to learn how to walk with that foot of giving what we can, because there is, people do need that assistance, but also learning how to walk with that foot of justice to make changes, and how can things be restructured so that we don't have this situation.
When the labor movement was strong, public benefits improved. When the labor movement, the civil rights movement, the women's movement, and the welfare rights movement was strong. So, and between 1935 and 1975, and I've documented this literally with numbers, that during those periods when those movements were active, the standard of living rose, productivity rose, poverty fell. So it's, you call it pressure from below, political pressure. These movements, people have to get together and realize that they can and should do something about changing the way public resources are spent.
People who are in poverty would need to do what they've done in the past, and that's organize, and that's fight the power structures that want to keep them that way. And of course, the best way to do that is to organize around their own issues. If you remember the marches on Washington in the 60s, of Dr. King and others, what stands out in my mind are the signs they would hold up. It said jobs, housing, along with the signs that said, I'm a man. So there were two things being said there. I'm a person who has self-worth, and I need to be recognized as such, and I demand fair housing, fair jobs, fair access, but that's a ground-up movement.
I think it won't happen until the poor themselves make so much trouble that doing something about poverty becomes the more practical course. That certainly is the experience of the 20th century. Mm-hmm. It was when the poor in the 1930s made real trouble that the New Deal administration expanded emergency relief and then WPA. And again in the 1960s, it was riots that fueled the poverty programs of the 1960s. But they won't protest unless they have hope. So another reason for being so happy that Barack Obama and the Democratic majority has taken over Washington, because they, whether they intend it or not, they're going to give people hope. They are giving people hope. And hope is a critical ingredient of protest movements. George W. Bush administration, and even the Clinton administration before it, didn't give people any hope. Remember, even Democratic Party Clinton saying the time for big government is over. The solution to problems of education is school uniforms. Nonsense of that kind constituting his political rhetoric. And then we got George W. Bush, and the rhetoric became much, much harsher. It's not only that a leader like George W. Bush can't be moved by protest movements, but that kind of leader has the effect of suppressing protest movements. People understand that he won't bend and that you can get badly hurt. Now, Barack Obama, on the other hand, for one thing, he won with a new constituency. Not entirely new, but he won by pulling out youth voters on a really historic scale. Black voters, turnout must have been up around 85%. Latino voters, working class voters, and notice also that his support increased after he was elected, as the economy spiraled downward and George W. Bush became steadily more ridiculous. So Barack Obama needs those voters. He needs important blocks of voters who either are suffering hardship themselves or who will be empathetic with those who are suffering hardship. Mm-hmm. He needs them. And his rhetoric shows that. And people can hear it. They can, and that gives them courage. That gives them hope. Mm-hmm. They know that Barack Obama will not call out the National Guard if they protest at food stamp centers, for example. They know that. So there's a kind of dialectical relationship between political leaders that need voters and protest movements. Protest movements can be protected by electoral politics and the leaders that are thrown up by new constellations of voters. And not only protected by electoral politics, they can win ultimately through electoral politics. It's just that they don't do it simply by, you know, going out and registering to vote and then turning out on election day. It's that they take advantage of this electoral constellation to raise new issues and to raise them in dramatic and disruptive ways, mm-hmm. to raise them through social movements. Mm-hmm. We don't have the propaganda apparatus, we have the movements.
As we were finishing this film, new poverty information was released by the U.S. Census Bureau for the year 2009. Not surprisingly, the poverty rate got even worse during the past year, adding an even greater sense of urgency to an already desperate situation. The official poverty rate for 2009 was 14.3%, up a staggering 1.1% from the 2008 figure of 13.2%. According to the Census Bureau, the number of people in poverty is the largest number in the 51 years for which poverty estimates are available. That number is now 43.6 million people, an increase of 3.8 million people in just 1 year. During a 2-year period, when our government provided billions and billions of dollars to bail banks out of the threat of bankruptcy, millions and millions of our fellow citizens have sunk deeper and deeper into the quagmire of poverty. Yet we hear virtually nothing from public officials about how to help those at the bottom of American society, those who have been most affected by the massive job losses during this Great Recession. The only help under discussion in the U.S. Congress is whether or not the Bush-era tax cuts should be extended. Are tax cuts the solution to poverty? During the past 6 years, those at the bottom, the poor and near poor, saw very little of the Bush tax cuts. If the cuts are extended to 2011, that will continue to be true. In 2011, those making $10,000 or less will see a whopping $5, while those making between $10,000 and $20,000 will get $137. Those making $200,000 to $500,000 will get $7,489. while those making $500,000 to $1 million will get $19,495. And those making more than $1 million will see at least $128,832 more. For 6 years, those at the top have gotten the most out of these tax policies. The conventional wisdom is that the rich will invest that money and create new jobs. But what we have seen is nothing like that. Not only is unemployment staying high, but many people have given up even looking for a job. Isn't it time to challenge the Glenn Becks, the Rush Limbaughs, the Bill O'Reillys, the Rand Pauls, the Jan Brewers, the Robert Rectors, the Robert Samuelsons? Isn't it time to denounce them as not just wrong, but as selfish and uncaring and heartless? Isn't it time for all of us to share in the amazing wealth and resources of our country? Not just the rich and those who defend them. After all, whose labor creates that wealth?
Jesus Christ was a man who traveled through the land, a hard-working man and brave. He said to the rich, give your goods to the poor. So they laid Jesus Christ in his grave. Yes, Jesus was a man, a carpenter by hand, his followers true and brave. One dirty coward called Judas Iscariot has laid poor Jesus in his grave. He went to the preacher, he went to the sheriff, told them all the same. Sell all your jewelry, give it to the poor. So they laid Jesus Christ in his grave. When Jesus come to town, the working folks around believed what he did say. Bankers and the preachers, they nailed him on the cross, and they laid Jesus Christ in his grave. Now the working people followed him around, sing and shouted gay. But the cops and the soldiers nailed him in the air, and they laid Jesus Christ in his grave. Where the people held the breath when they heard about his death, and everybody wondered why. It was the landlord and the soldiers that he hired that nailed Jesus Christ in the sky. This song was made in New York City of rich men's preachers and slaves. If Jesus was to preach like he did in Galilee, they would lay Jesus Christ in his grave. Yes, Jesus was a man and a carpenter by hand.